是秘密，在无声无息中消失，总是找不到回忆，找不到曾被遗忘的真实。一生一世的过去，你一点一滴的遗弃，痛苦痛悲痛心痛恨痛失去你。也许分开不容易，也许相亲相爱不可以，痛苦痛悲痛心痛恨痛失自己。情深缘浅不得已，你我也知道去珍惜，只好等在来生里再踏上彼此故事的开始。
Okay, so let's start from the beginning. Let's talk about how Alexander, your alter, ended up in Montauk.
Okay, have to start with his origin story, what I believe is his origin story. He is a clone from me, made in 2007, and then the clone was made into an embryo and sent back in time and put into a surrogate mother. His surrogate mother was a CIA operative. Both of his parents were CIA operatives, operating out of a naval base, United States naval base, on the island of Okinawa in Japan. And he was born on February 25th of 1956 at this base, which was really more of a forward operating CIA facility for spying on East and Southeast Asia. And from first breath, he was subjected to MKUltra type of things. When he was three, the family moved from Okinawa to another underground facility underneath the city of Morelia in Mexico, in Michoacán state. And they would sometimes drive up also to program him at Disneyland in California, which was not a terribly far drive from there. And then when he was seven, he was sent to Montauk. He was picked up from, his parents drove him up to Lukeville, Arizona, which is a border crossing town really, and he was picked up in a black van, which already had some other kids on board, and they made more stops to along the route, going all the way up from Lukeville, Arizona to Camp Hero. And this was in the spring of 1963, so he was barely 7 years old. The drive was extremely long and brutal. There were no stops for the bathroom. They did not issue any food or water. I think at least one of the kids who was in the car died along the way from, you know, shock, exhaustion, starvation, whatever. And they arrived at Camp Hero in the dead of night, and it spiraled from there.
Okay, before we get to Montauk, can you say how you found out that you said you were cloned and the embryo was sent back from 2007 back to 1956? How you found that out, and who do you think did this whole operation of sending the clone back? Was this the Montauk people?
I got that all from my memory. I know it was in 2007 because that is when I was taken to Cheyenne Mountain Complex, which, by the way, is now the headquarters of Space Force. Back then, of course, Space Force did not yet exist. But I was taken there. I was 6 years old. I was mind fractured, which they did it a lot differently than how they did in Penny's generation. They did it a lot faster, too. What took years in her generation in my era took about 6 weeks and they may have even sped it up further in the intervening years between then and now. But who did this? No, it was not the Montauk people at all. It was an eclectic blend of Noctuapan, naval intelligence, and the Air Force. Noctuapan, I know, are the main runners of that base, or they were in that era. Again, it may have changed. But they did that, and they took copious blood, skin, and hair samples from me to grow clones and place the altars in. Which, by the way, they can do that now. This thing Penny talked about in one of her more recent interviews with you of how you're physically gone the entire time, even when they're using the clones, that's outdated technology. I'm not saying that there aren't still some who's using it, because I have no doubt that there are. However, it's what most groups do these days is they just have soul fragments and DNA samples on file, and they can do that without interfering with your regular life whatsoever. You'll only know it happened when that altar dies and returns to you. Will you even know that anything was done? What can I say? Oh, how I know it was in 56, because I've actually done some remote viewing and I've looked at documents pertaining to my alter Alex, so I know, that's how I know his date of birth. And I have fleeting memories of the location, that's how I know where it was. Like I said, they left when he was 3, but it's still just long enough for me to have a few glimpses of it.
And number 2, you mentioned the Disneyland in California. There have been many witnesses, well, several witnesses, that said that Disneyland was a major mind control area or facility. And can you maybe elaborate on what was going on there?
Disneyland, in that time period, I know there was a lot of programming going on there. The main part that I remember is that there was a room underneath the Snow White ride, I believe it was, where they would perform rituals where large groups of quote-unquote characters, people in costume, like the people who would walk around in the park and meet and greet guests. They didn't look like cartoon characters. You could tell they were real people. Would come in and sexually act upon small person. I'm trying not to say words that will get your channel in trouble. But that was what that entailed. And I also remember there was being portaled out of the Disneyland Hotel, which is still there. I don't remember where the portal went to as of this time. That's what happened at Disneyland that I can recall so far.
All right, thank you. Now let's go to the beginning of your Montauk experience then.
Beginning of Montauk, okay. Arrived, like I said, in the dead of night. There were about 6 or 7 kids in that van. But there were many other vans. I would say probably conservative estimate 10 other vans that all had varying numbers of children in them that had been picked up from some from across time and space. Some had just been grabbed off the streets of New York or Toronto and several other major cities. And it looked like nothing so much as arriving at a concentration camp. The roads were lined up with Air Force personnel. You could tell they were Air Force with their uniforms. They had cattle prods, and some of them had Dobermen. And they would unload these vans. Kids, of course, screaming and crying and begging for food and water, because none was issued on the drive there whatsoever. And they were being cattle prodded and herded along with these dogs into the radio tower. And one thing I must also mention is that it was very much like the Tower of Babel. No one could really communicate with each other, or very few people could. They were bringing kids from across the Western Bloc, from not just the U.S., but Australia, Spain, Sweden, Argentina, South Africa, the Philippines, Germany, wherever. And couldn't speak each other's languages, of course, for the most part. And got marshaled into the radar tower, and inside, or you went down some steps, and inside there was a large room with a drain in it, and a kid standing around with a fire hose hosing you off. It was a weakened flow, so it didn't like blow you across the room or whatever. But it was ice cold, you were hosed off, stripped down, your head was shaved, and you were marshaled into the cages. And after that, you waited. You waited until your name was called by someone, and they would come collect you. Most of the kids, they put through the chair, and most of them, they just died, and were never seen again. I on my altar, they already knew what he was capable of. He was not ever put through the chair. He was put to work in various assignments. There was training going on to an extent, to the point where there was actually a graduation ceremony in 1969, which we will get to later. His first assignment was in the Historia Abteilung, which is the people who, or Historicity Department in English, which is, it was overseen by a paperclip Nazi by the name of Helmut Malovic, and he was a bit less horrendous to us than some of the other people. So, from the start, Alex had a somewhat privileged position. And so that was what he was doing, was remote viewing, pretty much, looking for discrepancies in the timeline. Or remote viewing as missions were going on, watching them. And as time went on, he went on to have many other assignments. He would occasionally be picked up by people from other organizations who would comb through Camp Hero looking for kids to pick up, because it was convenient, really. That's the basic overview I can go with for now.
Okay, thank you. Can you talk about the selection and the training process?
There were kids who were pre-selected. How exactly they found them, I don't know. I can only assume that they must have had access to CIA records or to other records of some kind, finding bloodline children, which is how I was found and how a great many other people were found. The others were grabbed randomly off the streets of New York and Toronto particularly, but also other cities around the world. Cape Town, London, Berlin, Stockholm, Saigon, you name it. And the kids of bloodline families were never put through the chair, or well, okay. Some of them were, but most were not, because they knew that they would not survive. They knew they had other uses, other psionic capabilities, so they would put them to work quickly in that sense. And I might add that of approximately 2 million kids who were brought to Camp Hero, around 70 of them survived the chair and were good enough with it that they could become operators. We had a term for them. They were called simply the few, because for obvious reasons. The training is difficult to describe. There was actually very little that you would recognize as formal training. In most areas, there was for martial arts, formal training in the art of Kali or Eskrima, which is out of the Philippines, I believe. And there was some training of some kind in the psionic abilities. I am in fact in contact with two women who were trainers in that field. They were, how shall I put this, other than that, there was very little formal training as such. You kind of learned what to do because you saw other people doing it and You just kind of knew what was expected and needed of you at a given time. It's difficult to put other ways, but eventually they would decide that you had done that to a degree that they were satisfied with, and would there would be a graduation ceremony, which we can talk about later if you're interested. And they would do that for, because kids did arrive in batches, there would be a large group, or, well, a group of varying size of the at these graduation ceremonies. And you were usually between the ages of 11 and 13 when you, quote-unquote, graduated. And a lot of them, a lot of those people, when they, quote-unquote, graduated in that era, would be then sent to other places, off-planet or to other programs. Not very many stayed, but my alter Alex was one of the ones who did stay.
Okay, can you describe the chair room, and what did a regular session in the chair look like? Also, how did the chair affect different kids?
Having never used the chair myself, I'm limited as to what exactly a session in it was like, but I did witness it, of course, on innumerable occasions. It was a pretty much just a huge round concrete room. There was kind of a metal walkway up above with stairs leading down. It was a massive room. It was the size of a small warehouse. And there was the chair, and next to it there was a, what would you call it, a stargate, I guess, a stargate ring. And you were, when you were in the chair, you had to open that, operate that stargate or portal using the chair. And at the foot of the chair, there was a mirror set up so that you could, the person using it, they couldn't actually see the Stargate ring, but they could see it through that mirror that was at the foot of the chair. Other than this, the room was completely bare. And the kid or the person, because they weren't always all children, would sit there, they would open up the portal, and then us, the operatives going on our missions, would go through and be there for however long we were there for on this operation, anywhere from a few minutes to a few decades, literally. We would do quote-unquote life missions where we would be gone for decades or more. If you were going to a place where people lived for hundreds of years, you very well could be there on mission for hundreds of years. That was not unheard of. How it affected them, most kids would simply die immediately on trying to operate it, or they would be able to operate it for a few seconds at most, and then they would die. And most of the ones who died were unsalvageable. They would find that the circuitry, or whatever you want to call it, in their brains had been completely fried and could not be salvaged. That's why so many of them were simply never seen again. Not so much because they just didn't care, because these kids couldn't do it anymore. They would have salvaged them if they could have, to use them in some other fashion. And a few of them did have enough salvageable brain material that they were regened and put into other uses, either at Camp Hero or elsewhere. Some kids would, as Penny described it, go interdimensionally, or some of them would be inaccurate with the chair. They would not open it to an accurate location, but were still operating it, and those kids would be taught in some way how to use it. Again, having never been one of those kids, I can't tell you how exactly this was done, but I know that that is what was done. And some of these kids would had been known to open a portal into the astral and bring things back with them. Sometimes that was specifically requested. And of course, that's also how Junior came about, which we will get to probably if we ever do any shows on Kyle. We'll get into that, because he was the one who was stationed at Camp Hero at the time of the Junior incident. That was not at all, that was long after Alex's time.
Okay, and since you mentioned a paperclip scientist, can you say how many of them you remember being there, and what can you tell about them?
Okay, there was the one who ran the Historische Abteilung, or the Historicity Department. His name was Helmut Manowitz. I've been unable to find any records of him anywhere. But he I'll talk for a minute about... He took power in kind of a silent coup in 67. He was then ousted in 71 by Preston. But when he was ruling Camp Hero, things began to improve very slightly. There was less torturing going on, and there was less beating kids to death because they couldn't speak English and understand the orders being screamed at them. But, you know, it was nowhere near enough, you know. But how many were there in total? I would say probably in the 60s and 70s, I would say probably 10 in total. Paperclip scientists. There were many other paperclip personnel who were not specifically scientists. There were other paperclip personnel who were historians, who were spies, who would train kids in spying to an extent, or who would simply lead groups of kids to go on spying operations. I know of one paperclip woman who was simply a file clerk, and how she got such a lowly position, I don't know. She must have been being punished for something, but that was the case. What I remember about them, the one I remember the most is this Monovitz fellow. He took a shine to Alex for whatever reason. I don't know why exactly. I guess he liked the way that, he liked the way Alex did his job, I guess, and he was, he found him impressive in some way. Alex did kind of have an air about him that commanded respect even when he was 7 years old. So, that was how Alex, after his graduation ceremony, wound up working until the end of his time at Camp Hero, actually, in the Historische Abteilung. This file clerk woman I mentioned, I remember she was quite awful. She was about everything you expect from a Nazi. She would prey on underage boys and all sorts of things. And there were others who he didn't really associate with very much. He just kind of saw them around, and you kind of knew where people were from because either they would wear the correct uniforms or you would just kind of hear people chit-chat. You know, office gossip is universal, really. And I know there was one, I have no idea what his name was. It was not Mengele, but he was a doctor, and everyone was absolutely petrified of him. No one really, at least none of the kids in Alex's group, knew his name. They just called him, oh gosh, what was their name for him? They called him Captain Hook. Yeah, they called him Captain Hook because he didn't have a hook for a hand, but he had a glass eye, and I guess that was the only pirate name they could come up with. Yeah. They called him Captain Hook, and there's actually a song that was written at Montauk that makes mention of him. And, like I said, people were absolutely petrified of that man.
How do you explain the amount of recall that you have at such a young age? Why do you think you remember so much?
I've been told by people in the project that part of it is down to my blood type, which is AB negative, which is the rarest type, by the way, so that's why there's very few people who remember so much. And also, I don't know why, otherwise, it's just for whatever reason the mind wiping just has not worked. There are people I'm in communication with someone in her 50s who is just now coming to realize she was in this. I never had that luxury of not knowing I was in it. I've known about it since the morning I woke up after my first abduction when I was 6 years old in July of 2007 in Colorado. My first memory is from that night, and ever since then I have been getting them on a very regular basis throughout my life. I just had no explanation for any of them until, July of 2019, when I more or less by accident stumbled across Penny's testimony, and it was an immediate click, and I knew that had to be it. And what was an even bigger click was the video links directly under that one was a Max Spears video, and I immediately, instantly, when I saw it, recognized him. And by the way, I don't talk about my memories of him, because that's incredibly personal, even though it is also quite expansive, but I recognized him. I had been seeing him in my memories since I was a kid. So, all my life, I've never had the option of not knowing. I just didn't know what it was. And the floodgates opened once I started actually acknowledging it in 2019. And I started reaching out to people in early 2022 or late 2021. I can't remember exactly, but after all that, I eventually went public, and here I am today. I didn't know about Montauk, really, although I've had memories of some of it. I didn't know what Montauk actually was, which I'll get to in a second, but when someone, I believe it was Joseph, told me about it in September of 2022, I guess, late 2022, I know it was. And the reason I didn't know what Montauk was is because no one talks about what it actually was. I need to make this, I guess, a bit of a public service announcement, that people only ever talk about the misery and how they were kept in cages and beaten to death every day and all of that. That wasn't what it was about. What it was about was time travel. It was a project where you were taken to do a job. It was not a place where you were taken to be tortured. You were taken there to do a job, and people did do their jobs, day in and day out. And yes, it was a painful process, but you weren't there to be tortured. You were there to work. And that is a thing that is severely under-discussed, and I think there are a lot of people, I know there are a lot of people who have come to me with memories and they couldn't explain them, and I was like, that's a Montauk memory, and they were like, what? I thought that was just about torturing kids. And I was like, no, it was a time travel program. So, yeah, that's an important thing that people need to know, is that it was a time travel and time manipulation and, I guess, general manipulation program. And that there are key signs that you may have been a part of it, even if you don't remember being tortured and everything. This photograph is of the Montauk Manor. It's still standing. It is an absolutely massive mansion. It is now a hotel, a very expensive hotel. It's a mansion built in the Bavarian style, I believe. During the Project Phoenix period, when it was within the time bubble, it was home to Preston Nichols. He lived there in this place, and it was the location of some incredibly lavish parties. Incredibly lavish, with people from across the planet, the militaries, and also from people in the Breakaway and in the ICC, and even occasionally some aliens would come for parties there. They were very extravagant and over the top. People would, there were some Eyes Wide Shut style parties there as well, and the big thing I remember from there was, there were actually some goodish times there spent with my trauma twin, which I will not go into detail about because it's not just my story to tell. But at any rate, that's what I remember about the Montauk Manor. This is a house that's near Camp Hero. It's on the road to Camp Hero. This is the house that was lived in by Helmut Monowitz, the paperclip Nazi who took power over Montauk in a silent coup in 1967. He took a shine to Alex, and so Alex was a frequent guest over at this house. It was very nasty decor inside, you know, about what you'd expect, really. And I remember his wife made apple strudel from scratch by hand, which is, if you know anything about cooking, that's an incredibly difficult thing to do. It takes 2 days at least, but she did it, and it was extremely good strudel. And he also threw parties. I remember I have some rather fond memories, actually, of Christmas there. I remember he would send Alex on little rogue missions, and the meetings would always be at his house. Little things for him personally that Monovitz wanted done. Okay, these two buildings are of considerable significance to the early stage, before about, I'd say about 1972 is when they altered this. Building on the right was our first concert hall, so we would hold concerts with both people who you would recognize, but also just music that we had written. And we would play it there, and oftentimes it would be stolen, which we will get to in the musical episode. Building on the left was for housing non-human dignitaries who were visiting for this reason or that reason. People came and went for all sorts of reasons. But yeah, that was what the building on the left was for. I don't know if these buildings are even still there. They probably are, but I don't know. Side of the Marine Corps barracks, where Marine Corps soldiers, American Marine Corps to be clear, soldiers would come, where they would be housed during their time at Camp Hero. I remember some of them were actually good to us. I remember hiding there. There was one in particular who was good to me, who would secrete me away either inside the barracks itself or in a crawl space underneath it when I was dodging work details, picking people up for this job or that job, which is what you spent a lot of your time doing, was dodging work details, or if there was a good one, because there were some good ones, trying to get in their line of sight so you would be picked up. But this is where I and several other kids would hide. This is the new concert hall. I have not been able to remember what purpose it served before about 1972 when it became the new concert hall. So many iconic songs from around the world, particularly the USA and China, which again we will get to in the music episode, were played in here for the very first time in history ever. Yeah, there's a lot of history that happened in there, and I hope someday it gets acknowledged. Behind it you might be able to barely see the top of a chimney. It's a lot shorter than it once was. It appears to be part of this building, however it's not. It is connected to the underground, and when he arrived at Montauk, they would point to that chimney and say, "Hope this place is to your liking, because your only way out is through that chimney there." And so it connected to a crematoria, which was underneath this building. So oftentimes you would be serenading, as people in the concert hall would be serenading as their comrades went up in smoke, just a few feet away from them. Pretty sick, yeah. This building is what is now the Montauk Community Church. It was once the home of the Historische Abteilung from during all the period when Montauk was in time bubble, so from 1971 until 2014. I assume the Draco and the time bubble are still using it for something. But before that, it was just a storage area, but eventually the Historische Abteilung expanded considerably. It needed this bigger office space, and the older space it had occupied, which was in the underground portion, became the ICC annex, and both stayed in that until Project Phoenix left Camp Hero in 2014. This is the entrance to the German single men's barracks. It'll be a lot more prominent when and if we do a video or a series on Kyle, because this is where he lived. But this was where German single men or officers would stay, and sometimes a very few boys of the privileged class who were the sons of these German officers. We'll get into that, I'm sure, we'll need to do an episode about just daily life and about the political and class structure of Camp Hero, because that was kind of an integral part of living there. Yeah, okay. That's all I really want to say about that for now. Okay, these buildings were apartments for some of the privileged officers, I believe, privileged predominantly Air Force men and women who were the ruling class, really. In all of their years there, neither of my elders ever saw the inside of these places, not once. So I can't really tell you that much more about them, other than that was their function. Okay, there are two things in this photograph of note. One is the obvious building that is behind the group of people. That building was an armory, and it was much bigger than this. It went many, many levels underground. Many, many levels. And there were, you could find a weapon for just about any situation in any time period anywhere in the world. It was absolutely tremendous, this place. What I really want to draw attention to, however, is what's in the foreground is the mostly but not entirely grassed over foundation that you can see. It was the situation room, is what we called it. It was where briefings were held of all kinds. Spent, I don't even want to imagine how many hours of my existence there in that place. And there were, this was where the actress Judy Garland worked, or maybe it was a clone of her, I mean, who knows, really. We'll get into her story more with when we do the celebrities special. But she worked there as we called her a psychic report reporter. She would record everything in her brain and then upload it psychically into the Montauk mainframe computer. And by the way, this is technology that they had since at least the 60s. So, you know, just imagine that, really. But, okay. Yeah, that's good. This parking lot was once a landing pad for craft of usually TR-3s who would bring transports of kids from off-world or who would take kids off-world to do operations. Sometimes they didn't always use the portal for reasons that, again, I don't know, if they didn't tell me. But this, I'd also like to draw your attention to the cliffs back there behind the parking lot. There would have been kids taking flying lessons back there, physically, bodily flying, running off the cliffs, levitating and doing loop-de-loops in the air and then landing back on their feet back up on the bluff. It was quite a sight to see. Yeah, quite something. This is going to get me a bit emotional. This is a view towards the lighthouse. The top room of that lighthouse is where myself and my coma twin would escape to get away from it all. We would write songs up there. I've since learned we didn't have privacy even up there because there are people who remember in the community who remember standing at the base of the lighthouse and hearing the songs. So, yeah, there were speakers up there, so we didn't have privacy. But, yeah, we spent a lot of time up there, and there was an entrance into the dome from the lighthouse, or somewhere around it, I believe, possibly down on the side of the cliff, and it's been covered up now. I'm not entirely sure. This is how I got to work every day. This is the walkway up to the backside of the radar tower, which you must envision it. Actually, I'll talk about what it was like in a moment, but this walkway into work was called the Highway to Hell, for a good reason. This was the visitor's entrance to the underground portion. They would walk up here. You can see there was once a doorway, a very broad doorway, and inside there would have been storage of small vehicles like hover bikes, motorbikes, very small little craft of various kinds, and then an elevator down into the lower levels where all the excitement was. I had to escort people in and out of here many times, many, many times. This is near the radar tower. As you can see, this building, I believe, is gone, but it was, and you can see the door going to the underneath it. This building, I believe, was partly used for observation into space, but also it housed equipment of various kinds, alien equipment, technological things being repaired, things of that nature. There was a man who worked in here who was a friend of Alex's and who was more or less the head guy of the black market, which we'll talk about in the Daily Life at Camp Hero video. Yeah, this was a very strange place, I would say. This house I actually have a lot of fond memories of. There was a man who worked at Montauk periodically. He would come and go, and this was his house. He had connections in the breakaway that allowed him the privilege of having his house. And there were some kids there who were, including Alex, who were privileged enough to come there. There would be barbecues in his home, at or outside the home, with him and his couple wife. They weren't actually married, but that was the cover story. There was a weeping willow in the back, and I know that was where a lot of the songs that my trauma twin wrote or written was under that weeping willow. She would just lay back there and write songs and poetry. this is the building that was known as the White House or the Weisenhauser, which was Al Bielek's house. He was terrified of me / Alex and also of Kyle. So I never once saw the inside of it when he lived there. He did after he left. People would avoid walking by there because, especially kids would avoid walking by there because he would grab them to take them inside and you know what with them. This is the front door to the Naval Intelligence Barracks. They were some of the cruelest and worst people at Camp Hero after the Air Force people. The Air Force people were the very worst, but this was another place kids would avoid walking by because, again, they would be grabbed and taken in, or they would be picked up by Naval Intelligence people who were looking for someone to fill out their work detail to do this or that, and it was usually not very pleasant work. It was usually some really nasty combat mission or going to a party where you would be raped or something like that. It was a really awful place. Yeah. This is the path towards the lighthouse. It is a big part of the highway to hell, because you would walk from your barracks all the way along this, up past the lighthouse, and all the way to the radar tower. It was quite a long walk, so yeah, and people would bitch and moan about having to walk that far to get to work every day, but you know, you had to do what you had to do. This is the offices that some aliens worked in, including a black reptilian by the name of Ezekiel. I don't know what species he was. He was not a Draco. He was some other reptilian species, of which there are millions. But he was very good to us. There's the tree there in the foreground. I'm not sure exactly what kind of tree that is, but actually I think it's a tree. Ezekiel gave me the seeds for it, and he would have me come and water it every day, I guess, trying to give me something to live for in that environment. This was the barracks of some of the kids who were too dangerous to be around others with their abilities. Very strongly psychic kids. They were kept because of this. They got, you know, their own private barracks and everything, and were kept away from the rest of us and were fed decently and treated fairly well. And so they would often give us things for the black market. Okay, there are two buildings here pictured. The one on the right was it was directly above a tunnel leading to the Plum Island facility, which was the sister location to Montauk, which was for several years where all the girls were processed before being brought to Camp Hero. We'll talk about that eventually, I'm sure. The building on the left was the punishment building, where punishments were handed out. I remember being whipped there with a braided leather whip that had metal rivets attached to it at odd intervals, and I know that my alter, he is still alive and is still active, and I've seen his back, and he still has some very nasty scars on his back from where his flesh just opened up like a Ziploc bag or something, being hit with that whip. It was, frequently it would kill you, and you would have to be put in the regen tank, and they would adjust the settings on the regen tank so that it would leave scars, so that whenever you took your shirt off in front of someone, they would see it and be reminded. So, yeah. These two big bulbous buildings, I don't really remember the purpose of. In between them, there was a house. You can see it in the photograph. A house lived in. It was lived in by a certain Dr. Maria, I will not say her surname, who was the lead programmer. She was something like the female Dr. Mengele at Camp Hero for many, many years. And she had two quote-unquote Dracos guarding her place. They were not sentient. Well, they were sentient. How do I explain it? They did not have Draco souls. They were the bodies of Dracos on a battlefield, presumably, been brought in, had been reanimated using cybernetics, and had a human soul shoved into them. So, you know, they did not have a Draco soul or mindset whatsoever. And they would guard her place. She had good reason to be afraid of people who might retaliate against her, and boy did they when her time came. And last, but certainly not least, is the place where Alex and where hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of kids arrived, never to be seen again. This is the entrance where people would come in to the radar tower to be taken in and processed. And you must envision it as it once was, where you see grass and trees and overgrowth and it being closed off. You must envision it as a much broader road, no vegetation around it, lit up entirely by floodlights all around on all sides, lined up and down with black vans unloading huge groups of kids who were being taken out to be processed, and all up and down the sides of the road there would have been men and women in Air Force uniforms with Doberman and with cattle prods. Every now and again they would just unleash a Doberman into rush the massive kids crying, begging for food and water. Some of them had to be carried. Yeah, this was this exact spot that you're looking at is the site of a massive scale crime against humanity.
It was a vision. I think it may be a memory from another timeline that is hopefully going to turn into this one, where there was a memorial built at Camp Hero for everything that happened there, where they bulldozed the entire site and replaced it all with rose bushes. They left the lighthouse up because, I mean, you know, the lighthouse does actually serve a purpose, so they left that up, but the rest of it became a massive memorial garden with rose bushes, one rose bush for all of the 300,000 and counting children who died. I have to make that very clear. This is an ongoing project. It is just not at Camp Hero anymore. And that with each one, with each rose bush, there was a nameplate with a name and a little inscription. I know for one of the ones, for one of the kids I raised, it simply said Ahoy Icarus, because that was his call sign. They all had something, an inscription that was personalized in some way to their experience or job or the way that they had died or their personality, whatever. And there was placed in place of the radar tower, there was a apologies, I'm getting a bit emotional, but there was a statue placed of a child in a spacesuit. They deliberately didn't show a face so that you wouldn't think it was any particular gender, and the spacesuit was clearly too big for them to signify that they were far too young for this. And it said in, there was a series of plaques in dozens of languages saying, with the inscription that it said, to the unknown lost boy, a spark at birth, a flame at life, and now a flickering ember in the night. I don't know if I came up with that or what exactly, but that's what it would say, what it's going to say, hopefully, when we get that built. And they also put up a memorial museum within the Montauk Manor house there with photographs. My son from the programs, who is still alive and is in space right now, Julius, we'll talk about him quite a lot when it comes to Kyle's story, but he has salvaged over the years before leaving Project Phoenix, he salvaged an absolutely incredible cache of photographs that we took over the course of the program, and they'll be donated to this museum. Those photographs and some others that people have somehow gotten a hold of, along with some of the artifacts we brought back and things like that. So, yeah.